decided we are going to call this Caustic Soda Cinematastrophes.
good choice.
Good, because we spent a lot of time trying to figure out.
We did.
Cinematastrophes. Uh-huh. Plural or cinematastrophe?
Oh, cinematastrophes.
It's an ongoing process.
For sure.
Yeah.
Got it.
We're doing something different for this episode. We decided to do a video-based episode,
mm-hmm.
and we watched two movies. Our special guestpert is Paul Chapman from the Greatest Movie Ever podcast.
So it's about one movie. Which movie is it, Paul?
Say what?
The Greatest Movie Ever is the name of your podcast, so which movie is it?
Oh, it's... they're all the greatest movie ever simultaneously.
Oh,
you know how an electron can exist as like a probability cloud before it's observed, then collapses into a particle?
Uh-huh.
Same basic principle.
Yeah. Got it.
Any given week, it's the greatest movie ever, and then it is supplanted and replaced.
Overlapping dimensions.
I like it. I enjoy that podcast.
Mm-hmm.
And how did you decide to come to make that podcast?
That is actually a very sad and ridiculous story. What happened was I was playing World of Warcraft entirely too much at the time, and I'd bought a $20 USB headset to use when playing World of Warcraft. Then my parents told me I was playing too much World of Warcraft, and I wasn't allowed to play World of Warcraft anymore, and I still had this $20 headset. So 9 years ago, I started a podcast thinking, I've listened to some other people. I could probably do this thing. It was a terrible mistake, and I've continued to make it on a mostly weekly basis since then.
That's amazing.
Yeah, at the time...
And you have guests.
Oh, I'm sorry. At the time, most of the people I knew were doing anime-related podcasts, and so I'm like, everybody's got an anime podcast. I'll do one about movies, not knowing that everybody else had a movie podcast, and now I have both. So...
Yay! And you have guests on your podcast as well.
Yeah, on occasion. Mostly people within my peer group, people I know through the internet and so on and so forth. You know, maybe one of these days I'll branch out into having, people that are in the biz specifically. But
Right. Yeah. And you have, Kevin's in the biz.
I am in the biz.
He is in the biz.
You can have him on your podcast.
And I know with you being our resident guest spurt, we turn to you to select our inaugural version of Cinematastrophes. And you chose which two movies, Paul?
Well, I tried to come up with the most caustic films I could think of off the top of my head, and I actually gave you an option of three, but one of them apparently wasn't available. That was Slime City, which actually would have been the gentlest of the films in question. But I just thought Brain Damage, Brain Damage, Slime City, Street Trash. These are all films that I think embody sort of the philosophy of Caustic Soda, the podcast. And I apologize
for
picking those because it'd been a while since I'd seen any of them, and rewatching them for this recording. They're a lot worse in terms of content than I remember them being. I think I had forgotten or perhaps blocked out certain aspects of each of these films.
What I find, I think, is that we're the ones that have changed, right? Back then, we were kids, and we weren't aware of stuff that would be offensive and things like that. And I find I'm watching all sorts of old media now and thinking, oh, wow, this was really bad.
I liked it when I was immature.
Yeah, exactly. Now that I'm an adult, this is problematic.
I didn't see either of these films as a youth.
Right.
These were both my first viewings of both of them.
Yeah,
so
same here.
I didn't have a nostalgia or a fond remembrance to fall back on to try and, to apologize for what I was watching.
Right.
To sort of, defend it. But I have lots to say. I can't wait to get into it.
Well, shall we do that then?
Let's do it.
That exact thing, the getting into it part?
All right. Are we going to get into it in the order in which we watch them?
Yeah, let's do that.
All right, brilliant.
Brain Damage.
Uh-huh.
1988.
The title doesn't lie. There is brain damage in this movie.
Yes, that's true. Director is Frank Henenlotter. Henenlotter?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Known also for Frankenhooker and the Basket Case series.
His name is that because eons ago, his relatives won a raffle for chickens.
The Henin Lottery. Yes.
Precisely.
Nice. Yeah. Now, Paul, have you seen Frankenhooker or the Basket Case series?
I've seen the first Basket Case movie. I believe he did another one recently called Bad Biology, which is even worse than this one in terms of its content.
Mm-hmm.
Let me just look at his filmography here. Yep, Bad Biology.
And by worse, By worse, do you mean better? As in more awesome?
Well, just...
Because this is what... This is the potential to be one of those movies that's so bad it's good.
I don't know. I seem to recall that the premise of Bad Biology involves a woman that has something along the lines of 8 cannibalistic vaginas and is capable of giving birth to mutant babies within a period of hours after copulating. So, I mean,
okay,
she's only one of the weird characters in that, too. So I haven't seen that one yet, and I'm not sure if I'm going to.
Right.
At that's this fair. Point.
No that's one fair. Would blame you. Mm-hmm.
It is currently 100% 5 out of 5 for critics on Rotten Tomatoes. That's Bad Biology.
Yeah,
but I'm guessing if there's only 5 critics, they're the 5 critics who love those kind of movies.
Yeah,
they're the 5 critics who watch these.
Who would agree to watch?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
and 3 of them were executive producers on the film.
Yes, exactly.
So the plot for Brain Damage. One morning, a young man wakes to find a small, disgusting creature has attached itself to the base of his brain stem. The creature gives him a euphoric state of happiness and hallucinations, but in return demands human victims so it can eat the human victims' brains.
Yep.
That's
basically the summary.
That's pretty much
it
the starts, movie.
It does start off that this creature's owned by an old, I guess, married couple.
Yeah.
But they don't reveal it for the longest time.
Now,
like, it's just missing and they freak
right.
out.
At the time when we were watching it, and they realized it was no longer in the tub, and they started to search frantically around the apartment for it.
Yeah.
Like, literally throwing plates in the air and
knocking over lamps.
And knocking over lamps and lifting up cushions and, like, looking behind things that it would have to be the size of an insect.
Yeah. Right.
To fit behind.
Yeah. Is it under this plate?
Yes. It makes it even more curious when we find out 20 minutes later what the size of this creature actually is.
Not only is it under the plate, could it be inside the break, inside the plate as they break it off?
Yes. Yeah, precisely. So it does, their search efforts are more frantic than useful.
Right.
I mean, she sits on the floor of the kitchen slamming cupboard doors and wailing.
Mm-hmm. Right. But they're in a bad way.
Yeah.
We do find out, like, I remember us saying, boy, I hope that this crazy overreaction is explained. Like, they give us a reason for it and not just, okay, now freak out more.
Well, the overreaction is explained, but their search efforts are not adequately explained. He literally takes a lamp that's a standing lamp with a base, with a very, very, very thin shaft that nothing could hide behind, and he picks it up and throws it and smashes it on the ground for no reason whatsoever.
He's just
to be fair, the properties of the Elmer character are a little bit protean. There's a little bit of, you know, cinematic logic in here in the fact that he's capable of fitting in someone's mouth and possibly throat without suffocating them while on the subway. Uh-huh. So we do have to remember
that. That's true.
He's a little squishy. Maybe he could, I'm sure he could probably ooze under a doorway.
Well, that's because that's the other thing, too. When we finally find out the nature of Elmer, it makes you wonder, how did he get out of the tub?
I assume he went through the drain.
Oh.
I assumed he went through the drain.
No, because the tub was still full of water.
Good point. I figured
the tub was still full of water.
Squeezed under the door jamb, possibly. And I got the impression that he got in through the slightly open window because there was one scene that framed the window that was open just a crack in what seemed like a significant manner. So I figured that was his mode of entrance into the apartment.
That same shot was used on another occasion as well in order to show his brother in his underwear lying on his bed. It's maybe a bit of a foreshadowing of staking his claim to Brian's girlfriend as well. The lead character's name is Brian, by the way.
Which is very close to Brain.
Very close to Brain.
They
should have called it Brian Damage.
I had a friend back in junior high whose name was Brian, and they misspelled it in the roll call for school for the first day, and he got called up as Brain Buckham. And the teacher just read it out, Brain Buckham. He's like, I think that's Brian. Oh, we'll get that fixed.
Got it. Brilliant.
That's how maybe nicknames are formed.
Movie.
Yeah.
By the way, the actor who plays Brian, not a great actor. Except for the scenes where he is suffering from orgasmic euphoria.
Right.
He nailed those scenes.
Which makes me think he's not actually acting.
I thought he also did a really good job showing the withdrawal symptoms. He seemed to be a real suffering bastard when he's jonesing for Elmer's juice.
Oh, I gave all the credit to the makeup job on that one. Mm-hmm. The shellacking with white paint that they obviously did on him.
Made him look like he barfed all over his shirt.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
For a low-budget movie, I didn't have many complaints about him, actually. Like, he wasn't terrible. He wasn't great. But when you're shooting this kind of movie with, you know, these kind of directors,
he doesn't really have that much to do
no.
in terms of acting, like, in terms of range or anything like that. He spends most of the time either just being euphoric or lying down.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I thought he did okay. Yeah, I had no... Certainly, we've seen a lot worse actors in these two movies mm-hmm. that we watched, and I would not put him anywhere near the top of the bad for that. I thought he was all right.
All right, so there's a creature that escapes from his captors, his elderly captors, who are feeding him animal brains, which mm-hmm. keep him weak because it's human brains
that he really needs. Yeah.
I don't understand why human brains... Do you think it's a volume thing? You think human brains are just bigger? Like, why are human brains more valuable?
Smarter.
Oh, it's like a synaptic thing.
Maybe it's just more delicious.
No, he talks about how they keep him weak on animal brains.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, anybody got any theories?
They did give him a pretty big pile of animal brains.
There were like 20 animal brains in that pile. So, 20 animal brains doesn't
equal one human brain. Maybe they're just giving a lot of brains to keep him logy.
Oh, so he's got like the Thanksgiving dinner kind of. He can't resist.
It's human brains are like the high quality nutritious brains, and the other ones are just like junk food brains.
Yeah,
and they fill them up full of popcorn and chips.
Yeah,
and
empty
stuff.
Calories.
Like, oh, yeah.
Usually when you have these kind of brain-eating mutant movies, there's some sort of explicit and ridiculous explanation in terms of science-y sounding things, often relying on things like hypothalamus. But no, nothing like that is provided in this film.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
No, nor is it needed,
no.
to be honest.
So.
The less explanation, the better, as far as I'm concerned.
Yeah,
you know, because when you have such a wacky premise, any exposition is going to be kind of ridiculous. So with the exception of the scene in the alley between the old man and Brian, there really is no exposition in this movie at all. Like, he barely touches on interpersonal relationships.
And Aylmer, this is the monster, this the old man explains, is an old English word meaning the all-inspiring famous one.
Okay.
And then he goes on to say that the creature has long since been forgotten.
That's yeah. Right. I guess that's an oxymoron.
The ex-famous one?
Yeah. So sometimes they call him Aylmer, sometimes they call him Elmer.
Mm-hmm. Yep. I like the fact that Aylmer's voice kind of sounds like cartoon Bing Crosby to me.
Right.
Like he has that sort of crooner kind of... Hey, how's it going?
Because no, we haven't.
Ryan, you and I could be best friends.
To me, he kind of sounds like a cross between like Tom Servo and John Astin, who played Gomez Adams in the Addams Family.
All right,
he's got that kind of a quality to it. Very kind of.
He does sing though, so he does serenade Brian when he's going through juice withdrawal.
Yes.
Right. So, you know, it lends credence to my crooner theory.
So let's go back a bit.
Okay.
So the plot is this monster goes to Brian's adjacent apartment.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Or somewhere else in the apartment.
Through
building.
The window or, you know, a keyhole or however he gets there.
And he attaches himself to the back of his neck.
Mm-hmm.
Or not even. He's there.
He injects it.
He injects this blue fluid. It's a very. I really like the design of the monster, because even though it's like turd shaped and blue, it's got when it does its thing.
Yep.
The jaw unhinges and lowers.
Yep.
And you've got all these little spikes and things.
Spiky teeth. Yeah.
And that sort of explains how he can attach himself to any part of his body that he so desires.
Yeah.
Right?
Well, he also has the suckers on his body as well that he can move around with. And then he inserts a little tube into the back of the victim's neck.
Syringe-like almost.
Tube. And then we cut to inside the brain.
Yeah.
The little probe comes in, squirts out this blue liquid, and then there's electricity.
Yeah, you did like the electricity.
Well, the brains look good. We commented several times that the prop department did a good job with the brains and that shot looked pretty good.
They did
it three or four times in the movie, and they didn't reuse the same shot, which I appreciated in a cheap movie.
The whole creature design part of this was definitely the star of the show, as it should be.
Yeah.
They spent their money wisely because they spent every dime on the creature stuff, the creature effects, for sure.
There was the cool hallucination of the lamp on the ceiling becoming a giant eye.
Yes, but it was done in cutaways.
Yes.
So it is like kind of cutaway to reaction and then cut back, and you know that some guy just ran in and screwed a new eyeball painted.
So this juice was basically hallucinatory, euphoric.
It's like heroin.
It was a
heroin
mashup
slash ecstasy.
It seemed heroin to be an ecstasy slash heroin mashup, because it was definitely when he went to the junkyard. It was a lot of colors,
yeah,
and flashing lights and shiny, and he was, you know, kind of running around wide eyed, and which from our heroin episode, I got the distinct impression that's not what being on heroin is like.
Right.
But the withdrawal is decidedly heroin-erific.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So, you know, the best and worst of all worlds.
So I don't mean to disrupt the flow of the conversation, but one of the things I noticed watching this movie, and I'm not sure if I'm reading too much into this, but this one came out in 1988, was made around 1987, I think. And mm-hmm. I was getting distinct AIDS vibe from this movie, specifically because at the right. time, the only people that were thought to suffer from AIDS were intravenous drug users. And there's the parallel with Elmer piercing the back of Brian's neck with his syringe-like thing. But also, there was a distinct homoeroticism in the way that the film was shot.
Oh, yeah. No, we noted on several occasions that when given the opportunity to show a naked female form mm-hmm. and a naked male form, he almost invariably, the director, chose the naked male form.
And also so framed it in such a reverent manner, like with the bodybuilder in the shower, for example.
Right.
Yeah.
Yes.
That guy got a lot of screen time.
True. At least the butt.
A lot of screen time.
Can you imagine the director offset? No, keep
rolling.
Yeah,
you are
up.
Not clean enough.
Lather up, big boy.
Lather up those muscles. Flex a little more for me.
Yeah. Well, you know.
Yeah, because he was in that shower when Brian walked in, and then when Brian went to change, and then when he came back, still scrubbing. Still scrubbing.
Absolutely. No, there was an undisguised homoerotic undertone to this entire film.
Yeah, like even when his brother had to go answer the phone, the scene was shot through a window.
Yeah, very Peeping Tom.
And he lays on the bed wearing nothing but his tighty whities.
Yeah.
And like it's his butts presented to the camera. It was total voyeur moment there.
Yeah, yeah. So I you know what?
I kind of appreciated that.
I never put two and two together with kind of the AIDS scare element of it. But I think that's a salient point, actually, that this is kind of, you know... Elmer is a physical embodiment of an AIDS scare.
A lot of body horror from the 80s is sort of interpreted that, and I don't know if that's just sort of applying a post view to it, but I mean, like, I've heard similar things said about, for example, David Cronenberg's The Fly, with the strange things happening to your body and not understanding where they're coming from and that kind of thing.
Horrifying.
That's
a good point. So Elmer, with his crooner or Gomez voice, then gets the electrical synaptic juices flowing, and in a hazy, hallucinogenic walkabout town, he plays courier to this creature who then finds victims to eat their brains.
Yeah, the first victim is the.
The Night Watchman.
Junkyard. Night Watchman. Yeah.
Who is wearing like a full-on uniform.
Like Air Force uniform or something?
It's a full-on uniform, which I bet you was not issued by his employer. He just chose to wear that. Yeah. Because as soon as he heard a sound, he drew his gun and like drew down on the obviously unarmed and not dangerous at all.
Who's literally threatening to maybe steal junk. Like, that's the worst that could be happening is somebody's going to steal some junk from a junkyard.
So he was a little overzealous, overzealous night watchman. So I was not sad to see him go. But the fact that Elmer burrowed through his forehead to get to those juicy, delicious brains.
Yeah.
Just goes to show those little spiky teeth do kind of an amazing job, a little... You know, circular saw style.
That's what I was going to say.
Brilliant. And you know, again, the creature effect where they had the waggling tail attached to the forehead with the gushing blood coming out from around the wound. Very well done.
Pretty good.
Very well done. Certainly one of the better efforts from this kind of horror movie that I've ever seen.
That explains why it lasted so long.
Mm-hmm.
Like... This thing is burrowing into his brain. It somehow got through his skull in like half a second.
Yeah.
And then it's just in there chomping, and yet he's able to be conscious and screaming and waggling his head for the camera for 20 seconds. Yeah.
Cinema, Joe.
I know. Keep it up. Keep it up. Keep it up.
And they're trying to stretch that movie out.
Yeah, exactly.
There was definitely a lot of time padding in the cut. There was a lot of like carrying people walking down a hall for like a full 10, 15 seconds. There was a lot of, holding on people thinking and a lot of people dying and flailing for a really long time after their brains have been eaten.
And that's what we came for, really, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
I came for a fine film. I showed up hoping beyond all hopes that we would encounter classic cinema.
Mm-hmm.
I actually kind of think it would have been creepier had they died and it just kept eating away at the brain. Mm-hmm. Like, because them being alive so long just made it campy and silly.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Like, I was like, yeah, there's a guy with a fake monster on his head screaming for the camera. But if it had gone chomp, chomp, and he'd gone, and then fallen down and just stopped moving, and it just kept wriggling and eating, that would have been creepier.
Well, I think, Joe, I think the director was going for campy and stupid.
Yeah,
and
it is a comedy.
The reason I know this is because when it attacked that guy in the bathroom stall, there was about, I don't know how many pints of blood are in the human body, but there was twice that much on the wall and the floor.
That was a lot of blood.
That was and just being squirted against the wall as if from a like garden
squeeze
hose
bottle. Yeah.
Or a squeeze bottle.
Yeah.
Speaking of questionable comedy, there's some sexualized violence in this movie twice, as a matter of fact.
Yes.
Maybe we could talk about those scenes a little bit.
Let's do that.
That was,
the scenes that I did not remember.
Well, they'd been cut out of the earlier versions, right?
Yeah, the blowjob one was definitely was cut from the theatrical release.
Mm-hmm. Paul, did you see this in the theater? Or
No, actually. The first time I saw it was on a DVD a couple of years ago, so I can't even have the excuse if I grew up watching this movie.
Well, it could be that you didn't see is it the director's cut or uncut version? Was there a DVD version without the blowjob scene?
Well,
Let's talk about it. He goes into a bar. He's high and looking. The monster's looking for brains to eat or something.
Mm-hmm.
And this completely drunk girl just basically throws herself at him and pulls him out into the alley for a blowjob.
Because he is the only non-80s style punk in the place, and she finds his suit intoxicating.
He's got a decent haircut.
He has a haircut.
That's right.
Right? There was enough hair product in that venue that if somebody were to light a cigarette, it would have been an inferno.
Yeah, just
like the aerosolized hairspray just floating free. Right. Like I probably would have walked in there, got high off of huffing.
Maybe.
Right? You know?
That's the draw to that place.
Yeah. So she focused on his suit and then almost immediately dragged him into the alley to have sex with him.
Yep. And then...
I guess in the 80s, I guess suits worked. I've worn suits lots of times. This has never happened to me.
Hmm.
So she unzips his fly.
Mm-hmm. Oh, before she unzips his fly,
okay. She
utters the best line in the whole movie.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, that's right. Because she's grabbing at his crotch.
Grabbing at his crotch, just in case we didn't know what she really was there for.
Right.
She's grabbing at his crotch and utters the line.
Feels like you got a real monster in there.
And then just starts going up into her brain and eating it.
So they're in the hotel.
Yep. The flop house.
The flop house.
Yeah. It'd be kind to call it a hotel.
Okay.
I mean, even Aylmer, who spends his life in buckets, bathtubs, people's butts, and their brain cavities... said, "Oh, this is a real dump." So
he's used to the finer things.
Yeah, and we did notice that there were just random scorch marks on the walls.
That's
which I
true.
Thought was odd.
It must have been like a firefight in there.
No, I think what happened is you had a production designer just came through with a can of black spray paint. It was like, "Ooh, that looks a little too clean right there."
Yeah, maybe.
Just red like scorch marks.
And they decide to basically have a kind of a contest. Who can go without brains or juice?
Juice
the longest.
Yes.
The longest.
Right. Brian
and,
loses
Aylmer
spectacularly.
Was very confident.
Yes, he does lose spectacularly. And that's where the song happens.
Yes.
That's where Aylmer is sitting in the sink.
What puts the kick in a chicken? The magic in June. It's just Aylmer's tune.
Serenadium.
Aylmer's tune.
Uh-huh.
As made famous by Glenn Miller in the 40s.
Right? Nice. It. He's got a beautiful singing voice.
He does have a beautiful singing voice.
Right? You know, when he unhinges his jaw and opens his mouth, you can't see vocal cords, but they're obviously in there somewhere.
Yeah. I just generally, I like the whole puppet. I like the design of the puppet.
Yep. I like the fact that his eyes are like super tiny, but they actually do move.
Yeah.
So, you know, there is some characterization. Like, he's not just this piece of rubber that, you know, you just whip out. It articulates. There are points where mm-hmm. you can hold it at a point where the tail moves, or it can be mounted somewhere where the head moves. So they probably had like 20 of these.
Maybe.
Creatures.
Yeah.
For use in all different situations. But my favorite part were the eyes, because, you know, they were, you know, very shifty sometimes, right. and very purposeful sometimes. And he would, like, you know, waggle his eyebrows, you know, if he was trying to get a point across. Mm-hmm. There was a lot of character in that face. More than I anticipated. That is for sure.
So Brian loses.
Mm-hmm.
Goes finding that's the shower. That's the shower scene.
Yes.
Is it not?
Yeah. Aylmer sends him out to find a victim so he can eat a brain immediately. Because now... Before, he was giving him the juice, and then as he was high, he would ride him to a victim. But now, because he defied him, he's going to force him to participate in the killing before he gets his juice. Mm. That's his punishment.
Mm. And then what happens after that? I don't remember.
That's the fountain of blood in the bathroom.
Yeah.
All right. And then, Brian says, I can't take it. I can't take it anymore. Give me the juice. And he's like, okay. And then he comes over and juices him up. And then he heads back to his house.
He goes back home.
Then he goes on the run and she follows him. She can't stay away. He even stops her on the street and grabs her and shakes her and says, get away from me. He's doing everything he can. I can't be trusted. And then she follows him onto the subway. Mm-hmm. At which point in time, we see a man with a basket.
Oh, yes.
Ooh, man with basket.
Man with basket.
He's got a snake.
What has he got?
It's got a padlock on it. It's got to be important.
Ooh. That's a callback
to Basket Case.
Basket Case.
This director directed a movie called Basket Case. It's a total callback.
It is the exact mm-hmm. same character played by the same actor from Basket Case.
And with the same hairdo, I might add. Because
we've
actually looked at an image. So I don't know if he wore a wig. Or if he just had been sporting that hairdo since Basket Case. But it's
the 80s.
What a great a nod and a wink to fans of his previous film. I mean, that is a pretty awesome Easter egg.
I'm sure both of them were very happy.
Well, I think Basket Case was kind of a cult hit.
Yeah, I think so.
But the girlfriend, of course, accosts him.
They start making out on the subway.
Pleads for another case, for another chance.
Meanwhile, while they're passing through tunnels, Aylmer is popping out of his mouth like a bullfrog or something.
Oh, yes.
Right.
Yeah, the one time we went, that special effect is
it is unfortunate.
Not good.
That pretty bad, yeah.
That didn't work. Yeah.
Because the creature effect had been working so well all along, I feel like they could have found another practical way to do it that wouldn't have been so distracting. But,
yeah.
C'est la vie, right? Every time she turns her head, Aylmer pops out of Brian's mouth. Yeah, so Aylmer is actually not
funny.
On his back anymore. He's living inside of him.
Yes.
Yeah.
And of course, when she leans in to make out, jumps to the chance, and girlfriend's brains are now eaten.
Here's my question.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay.
Why Aylmer can obviously move around on his own.
Not very well.
He moved from apartment to apartment.
Right, but in an act of desperation.
Yeah, we don't know how much
and
effort
we don't
that
know
cost
how long. We don't know how much time he had. Like, they were out of the apartment. They hadn't seen him for a while. Could be hours it took him to move, like, one floor and 20 feet.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so I was going to pose the question, does he actually need another human to get him brains?
Well, here's the thing.
Can he just go and, I don't know, be like an ambush predator?
Right.
Hang around in the toilet.
Mm. Okay.
Whatever.
Yeah, uh-huh.
Or does he take pleasure in making people do this for him?
I think he definitely takes pleasure in breaking people and bending them to his will.
Wouldn't we all?
There's an ego gratification component to this for sure.
I guess he could be an ambush predator, but you know those don't eat very often. But if he has a human he can ride around on, he can just whenever he wants to eat, he can go out for takeout.
And not only that, like, you know, I mean, Aylmer, everybody who spots him screams, right? You know? Mm-hmm. Like, in spite of his disarming voice, at first glance, it's a bit disturbing.
Yeah, he has a bit of the mutant penis monster thing about him.
Yes.
It's a little disturbing.
Yeah, he's in, He is intimidating, for sure.
He looks like Mr. Hankey's evil brother.
Well, speaking of the mutant penis monster, and I actually called him, like, during the recording of our viewing, I called him the mutant evil toilet brush.
Right.
Yeah.
But in the mutant penis monster, there is a scene that we skipped over, and very unfortunately, in which they're in the bath. Brian and Aylmer are in the bathtub together,
yes.
And Brian is squealing like a little girl,
with the yeah.
just so tickled pink. When Aylmer pops up out of the tub from between his legs,
that's probably my favorite scene.
I'll be right out.
Which, again, kind of connotes that perhaps that Aylmer pleasures Brian in more than one way. That doesn't necessarily include the juice.
Maybe.
Mm-hmm. What do you think, Paul? What's your take on that scene?
I think there's enough sexualized content in this movie that you can read that any way that you choose. I think there's enough evidence in the text for it, however you want to take it. Because that's the sort of thing that Frank Henenlotter does with his films. I mean, they're horror, but they're also there's overtly sexual elements to them, and they're weird and strange and meant to sort of get under your skin figuratively and possibly literally in the case of Elmer.
Yeah, I did not expect that giggling scene.
No, and the giggling carries over to a scene between the brother and the girlfriend standing outside the bathroom listening to him giggle.
Yeah.
So the giggling goes on an incredibly long time.
Things are getting really weird around here.
Not predictable.
Yeah.
This movie. That is a thing that you can say. It's not, it's a monster, it wants to eat brains, and you can figure out how it goes.
Well, the ending, I would say, is definitely not predictable.
Let's talk about the ending.
Well, we're there. I mean, girlfriend is dead.
Yep.
You know, Brian is, you know, has caved. There's no doubt that he is now Aylmer's puppet, you know, in every way imaginable.
He's the puppet's puppet. So he goes back to the trash can alleyway, I guess, behind his apartment building.
Right?
And then the old couple is there again.
Yes, with a gun this time.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
They are taking Aylmer back by force.
Because they are addicted to the juice.
How does that go?
I would argue it doesn't go well for anybody. I would argue nobody walks away from that sequence a winner, because old woman gets her brain eaten when she tries to force Aylmer to give her the juice.
Right.
Old man tries to force Aylmer to get off of his wife and give him the juice, gets his brain partially eaten.
Mm-hmm.
Aylmer stops eating the old man's brain because Brian, again, is, I can't take this. I got to get the juice. And he's like, I'm not done with this brain yet, but okay, Brian, just to calm you down.
Yeah.
He attaches himself to give him the juice. And the old man, although half his brain is gone.
That's right.
Not the half that doesn't permit him to jump up and grab Aylmer and squeeze the life out of him.
Right.
And in the process of squeezing the life out of Aylmer, a huge amount of juice is injected into Brian's brain.
Oh, that's right. Because he's still attached.
Because he's still attached. So he's squeezing the life out of Aylmer, and he's squeezing all the juice within Aylmer's body into Brian's brain.
Brian is ODing.
So Aylmer expires on the ground. Seems pretty obvious to me. Paul, what do you think? You think Aylmer's dead?
Definitely dead. We see the last
Dead. We have seen the last of Aylmer. Who knows if there are other Aylmers out there, but this,
we can only hope.
We're last of this one. And Brian begins to, his skull begins to distend in a very specific fashion on his forehead. He gets a big, like, lump.
Yeah.
And then the lump gets a lump. It's a double lump. It's looking like an ice cream sundae on his forehead.
Yeah.
I almost thought a new Aylmer was going to burst out of his brain. This was how Aylmer makes new Aylmers.
See, that would be the obvious route to go. But that's, you know, obvious is not in the vocabulary of Frank Henenlotter, because what really does happen at the conclusion of the film is just beyond bizarre and, like, inexplicable, I think is the best way to describe it. Because using the gun that he got from the old couple, he sort of, it's heavily implied that he shoots this growing bubo that's popping out of his forehead.
Uh-huh.
And then the cops and his younger brother burst in on him in the bathroom, and he's got just this scooped out cavity in the front of his skull with blue laser light shooting out of it and electrical effects.
Uh, A yellow, a giant, like yellow, like ray of sunshine.
Yeah, just a bright light.
Yes, a bright giant, like he's got a spotlight in his frontal lobe.
Yep.
And it's shooting out of the air, and you can see it out the window on the street below, and then it ends with like lightning strikes, like lightning is shooting out of his head. Anybody have any theories? Paul, you've seen this more than once.
I've seen it twice. I think this is kind of like an Akira moment. Like he's been given so much juice that he's actually turning Star Baby on us with his telepathic powers. But the movie ends so abruptly that it's really open to interpretation. I mean, we don't really know. He seems to still be alive, although he's got like, you know, sunshine pouring out of his brain.
Yeah.
Well, he's definitely functioning for now.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Where does it go?
Where does it go from here? Is there a
brain damage?
There is not. This is all you get.
Oh.
And I recall reading an interview, mm-hmm. or maybe it was a transcribed director's commentary, that he was not interested in making another one. He felt that the story was told.
I can't argue with that. Elmer's dead, after all. You know, I mean, it would take some serious retconning to, you know, come up with a sequel for this, but. Let's go around the table. Toren, theory? What caused this and what is the end result?
The ending of the movie?
Yes. What happens 5 seconds after the movie cuts? What happens 5 seconds after the movie cuts?
I want to say, so he's got the blue liquid coming out. I want to say he probably explodes. I want to say he, like, 5 minutes after that, he just falls on the ground and the light just goes everywhere.
Uh-huh.
And then maybe the entire town becomes slightly psychokinetic for a while.
Okay. All right. It's very Lovecraftian of you.
Yeah.
Yeah, precisely. What about you, Joe?
Yeah, I don't think he survives this for very long. Mm-hmm. I don't think this is the next evolution of mankind caused by blue poop juice or whatever the hell the alien's putting in there or the monster is. I think he has the biggest high of his life while he dies. I think that's what's going on, that he's like experiencing nirvana and dying at the same time.
Well, if this is an allegory to drug abuse or AIDS or whatever, mm-hmm. then yeah, this is kind of the moment where...
It's the overdose.
You know, it's the overdose or the whatever. I think it's a portal to another dimension.
Right.
Okay.
Tentacles come out of it and start killing everybody.
What do you think, Paul?
I think that it's more horrifying if he actually survives.
Mm-hmm. Oh, and just walks around with this giant spotlight on his head at all times? He could rent himself out to the Luxor Casino and just sit on the top of that thing.
Mm-hmm. But
and he can never love again because who can go close enough to kiss him? You got blinded.
Everybody's got a kink like that. Somebody's got a kink.
Oh, you just
like
find
that,
a blind.
Right? There you go.
That's the beauty of the ambiguity of the ending of the film, though. You can basically write whatever kind of ending you want to have after, you know, shining spotlight out of the brain.
Yep. Well, he does have juice like running out of the hole, like down his face. Like he could create like an army of addicts to do his bidding.
Oh yeah, he starts selling his brain juice.
His brain juice.
It's a new. It becomes Nuke for RoboCop 2.
Yeah, this is the prequel to RoboCop 2.
There we go.
Can it be the prequel to RoboCop 3? I want the splatterpunks.
Oh.
So, is at this point in time, we want to talk about what we thought of the movie and if we would give it a score or whatnot?
Yeah, let's give it a score.
Okay.
All right. So, I think I give this a solid, like, 6.5 out of 10. Like, this is, you know, eminently watchable. Far more enjoyable than I anticipated. I said it as you're watching, and I will continue to say it. It's weird.
Yep.
But there are enough things to like about this to encourage people to watch it.
It's got parts that I like, but it also has an equal amount of parts that I don't like or found to be dull.
Enough to turn you off?
I'm just going to say 5 out of 10.
All right.
I'm going to go right halfway down the middle.
I feel the same way. 5 out of 10 in that I really expected, we're going to watch a terrible movie and I'm just going to be like, and it's gross and weird. But this had some funny moments, some decent acting, some excellent effects. And it wasn't predictable and I appreciated that. And but at the same time, went on too long in spots, was boring, was badly acted in spots. 5. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I would recommend this. What about you, Paul?
Oh, I'd probably give it about a 9 out of 10.
Oh, wow.
If only because I'd like to gauge the reactions of other people watching it, getting more people, tricking them into seeing it, for one thing.
Street trash.
Now, Paul, I was just about to call you Brian. Now, Paul, what possessed you to recommend that we watch this film? Is it because it's maybe the most offensive movie you've ever seen?
Oh, I've seen worse. As bad as this is, I've seen so much worse.
Right. So much worse offensive or just so much worse made?
Both. Little column okay, A, little right, column right. B. Really, what this was actually the first one that I came up with when Toren contacted mm-hmm. me with the idea, because this movie struck me as caustic. I thought we were going right. to sort of like a caustic yes. theme, and I thought, oh, that would be a good choice.
And literally caustic.
Yes.
It's the one of the main characters of the film is a caustic substance.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Mm-hmm. Exactly. So.
Okay, so I get that.
Yeah, I'm sorry for inflicting this one on you guys.
No, it's great. I mean, well, it's not. It's a terrible movie, but it's a great choice.
It's a bad movie with some incredible camera work, in my opinion.
Yes.
And some surprisingly funny bits of dialogue.
We were watching it, and I was like, these are good shots. Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, and then until you actually like waited to the end of the shot and went, no, that... he just turned in a circle.
That's right. Right. Yeah, yeah. Oh my God, this is a oneer. Oh,
this
no,
is a oneer. This is really great. He's like going, he's like revealing all these characters and whatever, whatever. And then it comes back to his first spot. And you went, oh, no, they just put it on a tripod and turned in a circle.
Turned in a circle, yeah.
I still thought that was a dynamic shot. It was pretty interesting.
That's fair. It doesn't matter how they do it.
They do a good job fooling you into thinking it's a dynamic shot. But it is not a dynamic shot.
Isn't that the magic of cinema?
It's part of it.
Steadicam work, and this was really good. And when I looked up James Moreau, who's the director and also the Steadicam operator, that's his primary mm-hmm. job, is he's a camera operator. So
this is from 1987, and the plot is...
Bums melt.
Yes, bums melt, indeed. Uh-huh. The owner of a liquor store in Lower Manhattan finds a case of cheap wine, Tenafly Viper.
Uh-huh.
In his basement. It is more than 60 years old and has gone bad, but he decides to sell it to the local hobos. Unfortunately, anyone who drinks the Viper melts away in a hideous fashion. At the same time, two brothers find different ways to cope with homelessness while an overzealous cop is trying to get to the bottom of all the deaths, all the while trying to end the tyranny of the deranged Vietnam veteran, Bronson.
I'd like to believe that this... I think it's set in New York or some unnamed city that's like New
Manhattan.
York. It's Manhattan. I'd like to think that this is the same Manhattan from the Warriors movie.
Okay.
With all the like theme gangs.
Okay.
Right? And this is just their Skid Row in that Manhattan. That
right.
this is they don't go to the Warriors part where you see the theme gangs. But you just have this one part that the theme is populated by hobos.
Right. Hobo gang.
It's the hobo gang.
It's the hobo gang, precisely.
What did you call Bronson? What was his name?
He's a cross between Spartacus and Zach Galifianakis. Bronson, the crazy sort of king of the hobos, like he sits on a throne of sorts, throne of junk. And he is Spartafanakis is the only way to describe him, both in temperament and in sense of humor.
Who would you say is the main character of this movie?
We talked about this through the thing. Who is the protagonist,
well,
right?
Who is the hero of the story? Who's the hero of the story?
Yeah.
I think us for watching it.
I mean, let's deconstruct it. Yeah. Let's talk it out, right? Because it's certainly not Bronson.
It's not Spartafanakis. No.
The Spartafanakis is the antagonist. He's the one who creates all the problems. Mm-hmm. So it's not the liquor store owner. Because he only shows up to like peddle the goods.
Yep.
It's not the cop.
The cop's a bad cop.
That is a bad cop who does bad things.
Although from time to time you get the sense that he's the protagonist.
Yeah. In individual scenes, just about all these people feel like a protagonist.
Because of the way it's shot.
Point.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Right. Because they become the hero of their little sequence or whatever. Right. That features them. But, you know, when you talk about the definition of a protagonist, which is, you know, all the action revolves around this person and they are the one that both incites and resolves the conflict, our hippie hobo who gets as the first one to buy Viper.
The older brother of the two brothers.
Older brother of the two brothers. He's not the hero of the story.
He seemed like he was the hero of the story for most of it.
They were setting him up to kind of be, but he just, he's more like a chorus. He's just kind of there while stuff happens.
Yeah.
Yeah. He's not proactive.
I would argue that the younger brother ultimately is the protagonist of this film, which is strange because he gets some of the least amount of screen time of any of the characters.
Yes. I was about to say, because he's in the movie for about 15 minutes total, probably. Yeah. He's got a scene right at the very beginning, and he's got a scene right at the very end, and he doesn't have a whole hell of a lot to do in between.
So this is what Kevin and I realized, mm-hmm. that the protagonist of this movie is the Viper. It's the drink.
Yeah.
Because it's Viper taking out itself. Bad guys left, right, and center.
Joe, you are absolutely 100% correct.
Except he needed to share with the two guys. That would have been hilarious.
Viper was the hero of the movie.
Viper's the hero of the movie.
There's only a couple of innocent bums that die, but then didn't they all take part in the let's reveal horrible content warning?
Let's get to it in time. Everybody does horrible things, so everybody, quote unquote, deserves to die at one point in time or another. I think
the only sympathetic characters are the younger brother and the lady who works at the junkyard, whose name is Wendy,
and she allows the runaways to stay in the junkyard so that they don't become, quote unquote, homeless. But then Bronson and his, like, horrible cronies all live there as well.
Yes.
So I don't know if Wendy just ignores them or she fools herself into believing that they're teenage runaways as well. I don't know. But her setup and the dialogue in this movie is atrocious.
Yeah. Just
atrociously
awesome.
And hard to understand.
Yeah, the mix is not very good.
Well, not just the mix. There is a scene where they're at the coroner's, and the coroner, not only does he have a very thick foreign accent, which I can't tell what it is exactly.
He's eating a sushi and
very
a salad.
Thick foreign accent, but he spends the entire scene eating.
Eating cookies and sushi.
And then
eating
sushi.
Cookies, then sushi.
And delivering his lines only right after he takes a bite of something.
That's correct. He's only allowed to say something after he bites something with a heavy foreign accent. Everything that came out of his mouth, utterly indecipherable.
Sounds like my kind of guy.
Is this an actor who showed up to the movie and went, I cannot just leave, I'm going to make it so they can't use anything and they edit me out of this movie?
I have a theory.
Okay.
I have a theory that he is a friend of the director's or something, and he promised him a role. He goes, I got this perfect role. You got a lot of dialogue, but it's one scene, so you can kind of come in and out. You'll be in the movie. Bada bing, bada boom. Not realizing, because he's known for so long, how thick and indecipherable his accent is. He gets on set, starts to do his lines, and the producer goes, I can't understand a word this guy is saying. Like, he doesn't make any sense. So they go, okay, let's have him eat before every line so that there's a reason you can't understand what he's saying.
I think it's more like the guy shows up to do his scene. Mm-hmm. I was like, I only got 20 minutes, but I want to make use of the craft service table.
Oh. So he just like rolled off the craft service and then like, action, where's our actor? And he just like, it couldn't like
let's
put the
be
food
real
down.
Here. There was no craft service table in this movie.
Yeah, that's fair. Well. Yeah, maybe day old sushi and Girl Guide cookies.
Maybe he was the craft services person.
Oh yeah,
and he only agreed to do the job because it paid so poorly. But if they gave him a role in the film,
maybe.
Maybe he was an actual forensic investigator, and he was not aware that they were filming a movie.
Due to the liquor store,
right?
Finds the booze.
Yeah, by pulling off a piece of wainscoting that doesn't appear to have anything behind it, like why he chose. To move boxes and pull away.
Yeah, there was that 5-minute scene of him going through his basement going, oh, this is crap. This is all
mumbling
crap.
To himself the entire time about, I can't believe I have all this garbage down here.
Look at this place.
Look at this. How dirty it is. Gotta get this organized. Oh, this is crap. I can't sell this. Like the entire time mumbling to himself.
Well, you know.
Yeah.
So he gets the booze.
No.
Sells the booze to the older brother.
Yep.
The older brother...
for a dollar.
Puts it in his pocket.
For $1.
Yeah.
Pure profit because it's been lost for 60 years.
Puts it in his pocket, leaves.
Right.
And then he has a short meeting with some dialogue with another bum that I have no idea was going on.
Who pickpockets him.
Who pickpockets him.
Yep.
Takes it back to his little corner.
His toilet sitting out in the middle of an empty lot.
Yep.
Well, a ruined building.
Yep.
Ruined building, empty lot, but there's a toilet from the building still there.
Yeah, yeah, sure. Precisely. And this is, I think, Paul, this scene is the one that has this great Steadicam shot that you were talking about?
I was thinking of some of the chase scenes. There was some pretty good Steadicam work and just some other stuff like that. But yeah, this, I just like the camera movements throughout the movie for the most part.
All right. Okay.
Well, yeah, the director was the Steadicam operator for Titanic.
Well, there you go.
The director of this movie was Steadicam operator on Titanic.
I wonder if he and James Cameron talked about Street Trash the whole
moving
time.
Up in the world.
Maybe, probably.
Maybe he was just a big fan.
Only feature film
that's
he's
he got
directed
the job.
To date. Gee, I wonder why.
Yeah.
This, I think, is the best human melting scene.
The first one.
Yeah.
Oh, right. Yeah.
Yeah.
You mean in this movie or ever?
In the movie.
It's certainly the most iconic of the film.
Yeah. Right.
Right. So he's sitting on the toilet. Takes one sip.
That's all it takes.
It couldn't have been more than 2 teaspoons of Viper.
Right.
And instantly,
He
starts to leak very colorful fluids.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Like not the kind of fluids that would be inside a human body.
No, it's obviously changing him super fast.
I have a theory that they found a paint shop going out of business.
Yeah. All day glow items on sale.
All day glow pinks and blues and greens and yellows ready to move because they are having a clear out.
Yeah.
And this director said, I can use this.
I can make a movie around
this.
around this sale.
Because it's all neon pink and yellow and green and blue running down in his pants and running out of his sleeves and off the top of his head.
And basically he dissolves into the toilet.
That's right. His feet are left disembodied because the bones.
His hand, which was on the that old timey pole flush that they have hanging down.
Yep.
That
is
was left
hanging from the pole flush lever.
And eventually he just becomes a face in a toilet.
Yes. A face that is still moving and like jaw is masticulating and, you know, he is obviously, even though he has turned into a puddle of goo, he's still in some fashion alive. Right to the bitter end.
This is, researching this was how I found out about the term melt movie.
Oh, this is a thing?
This is a melt. Have you heard of the melt movie?
It's a subgenre.
Right.
A subgenre of what?
Of
not melting?
Bums melting, mostly.
Yeah.
I see.
Any film featuring a graphic depiction of human flesh bubbling and liquefying in a gruesome, gory, or gut-churning manner.
Yeah, other films in the melt subgenre would be things like Slime City or perhaps The Incredible Melting Man. Those are the two that immediately leap to mind.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Toxic Avenger?
I mean, to a point, yeah. I mean,
he's a little melted.
Okay. All right. So Street Trash is the granddaddy of the melt movie.
You could say it defines the subgenre, I think.
Mm. Mm. All right.
Okay.
And then RoboCop 1 has that awesome melting guy gets hit by the truck.
Yeah, but I think generally there has to be more of a sort of thematic framework of melting.
Right. It's not just a single scene in a movie that makes it a melt movie.
Right. Right, right.
Other favorite scenes in this movie. I really like the shoplifting scene.
Well, this movie, it's a lot more difficult to kind of walk through the plot of this film.
This is like, this movie is a series of vignettes.
Yes. Yeah. There is very little thread that ties the whole thing together.
Just our primary protagonist of the murderous alcohol.
It was even notable that we had the two melting scenes at the beginning.
Yeah.
We had a bunch of melting scenes at the end, but there was this big stretch where it's like, is there going to be more Viper in this movie?
There was easily 40 to 50 minutes of no melting in the middle of this film.
That was just like Vietnam War flashbacks.
Yep.
Yes.
Vietnam War flashbacks, shoplifting.
Yep.
Our two brother characters have a tire fortress. Yep. That you have to crawl through a car to get into.
That's kind of cool.
Let's not forget about the keep away scene.
Ah, yes. All right, so how do we want to attack this? How do we want to go from one to another? Anybody have a preference? Because this whole movie is kind of a shotgun approach, so I don't think really, unlike Brain Damage, we don't really need to take this step by step. Because all these things kind of stand alone. I mean, Paul, do you agree or disagree?
Yeah, I would generally say that the plot is not the strongest element of this film. And I mean, it's almost like there are several different movies going on simultaneously. Like Bronson is experiencing the torment of post-traumatic stress disorder and other various psychiatric illness as a result of coming back damaged from Vietnam. There's that one story. Then you've got the story of the two brothers who are runaways, also escaping from an abusive family relationship where their dad came back damaged from Vietnam and was, you know, taking it out on them. There's that story. There's the story of the cop who is going to try and, you know, bust the hobo crime gang, I guess, or try to solve the, the melt murder mysteries.
Yeah.
There's a story of a very sarcastic doorman and and his mob boss, which is probably the high point of the film, in my opinion.
Yeah. Not only that, we've glazed over Wendy rescuing runaways and also fighting off the advances of her creeptastic boss at the junkyard.
Yeah, she's got her own story.
Yeah, absolutely.
And there really isn't much connecting any of these separate plot threads together, except perhaps the occasional presence of Tenafly Viper.
And the occasional preference of overlapping characters.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So... I guess we might as well just jump right into the keep away scene because Joe already brought it up.
Sure.
So for no discernible reason. So Bronson is.
Was this right after the fight between him and the cop?
No, it was before. At this point, what led up to it was Bronson was menacing the older brother with a knife because the older brother owes Bronson
because he owed him money
because he stole from one of his underlings. So he's menacing the younger brother with his knife, which is mounted on a human femur. For no reason. That's
the human femur knife.
That kind of thing. And while he's in the process of threatening him with this knife, another hobo thinks it's a good idea to relieve himself at that moment. And we go from there.
Through a hole in a fence.
Yeah.
Yeah, through this hole in the junk. For no reason sticks his dick through to pee. Mm-hmm. Not knowing that Bronson is there.
And he
gets peed on him.
Yeah. And chooses to use his human femur knife to sever the penis.
Yes.
He reaches through the hole, not knowing whose it is.
Severs it.
Cuts the penis off.
And then there is a 5-minute sequence in which the other hobos play a game of keep away with his penis that is accompanied by what can only be described as a comedy score.
It's circus music, basically.
It was worthy of Benny Hill.
There was a lot of hobo oboe in this movie.
Yeah. This is the most oboe I've ever heard in a theatrical film score, by far.
The scene where the bums and winos play keep away with one of the guy's dismembered members featured three different fake penis props.
Okay.
There was a small one, there was a big one, and there was a medium-sized one, and there was a large one.
Okay.
Okay.
Right.
And the actor was like, no, you got to use that big one. Come on.
Yeah.
It's going to be accurate.
Well, the largest one, the size of a football, was used for shots of the wiener flying through the
air. Which
they
do.
There were lots of those.
Slow motion, by the way.
Yes. Yeah. Yes.
There were lots of those. Now, I did find it curious, and not that there isn't a lot of suspension of disbelief necessary for this film, but I did find it curious that the man who just had his penis severed could manage to run around chasing after other
comedically
hobos.
Comedically trying to get it back.
Comedically trying to get it back in a game of, like, childhood keep away.
As though this is the music video for King Missile's song, Detachable Penis. And this happens all the time. And he's just got to stick it back on once these jokers
will
get it back.
Well, he said, I remember him yelling, oh, put it on ice, get it in a bucket of ice, or something like that.
Yeah, yeah.
But the running, like.
Yeah.
And then he eventually retrieved it, tried to catch a cab. Additional comedy when the cab's like, no way, Jose. And peels out of there, so he has to hitch a ride with a penis in one hand on the back of a school bus,
that's right.
Full of school children, no less.
Who are all screaming. Because there's a hobo holding a severed penis in his hand.
And
holding onto the
bus. We never saw that character before. We never saw him again.
Think of how prescient this movie was, though, in that it, like, predated the Lorena Bobbitt thing by the better part of a decade, I think.
I assume that the school bus was actually headed for the school. So.
Good luck, sir. School nurse,
well,
I guess.
Yeah, last time that bum saw a medical professional, it was a school nurse.
So that's where he's just heading back to where he knows.
Gang rape scene in the junkyard.
So this is the most disturbing scene of the film.
Well, it's disturbing, but it's also it's framed in such a manner that it's almost surreal because, okay, it's a thoroughly repellent scene on its face because the older brother, who's ostensibly the protagonist up until this point, mm-hmm. and seems like mm-hmm. you know, kind of misunderstood, a little bit of a petty thief, but you know, right. hasn't passed the moral threshold, if you want to steal a term from TV Tropes. Yeah,
the point of no return. Yeah. He hasn't crossed over to the other
he's
side.
Still a potential good
yeah, guy. He's wandering around. I forget exactly what the circumstances were for him leading up to this point, but he finds a woman throwing up in an alleyway outside of a fancy restaurant, and
yeah, I think he was just dumpster diving.
And she's...
I think he was in the process of dumpster diving, and she's out back throwing.
Yeah, she's clearly intoxicated, mistaking him for someone else and propositioning him for sexual favors, and he's like, oh, sure, why not? Which is, you know, rape. Period.
That's rape.
Mm-hmm. No two ways around it.
But
so he takes her back to the
to the tire castle
for some well,
sexual congress.
Yes. And while this is going on, like every other bum in the junkyard is lurking and doing like these really fey body movements, like they're creatures out of, I don't know, a Midsummer Night's Dream or something like that.
Yeah.
Rapist
yeah.
Well,
bumps.
It's very zombie-esque. Yeah. Like there's some zombie-esque kind of like.
When they've got smoke pots for the dry ice fumes, you know, like it's mm-hmm. weird, and mm-hmm. you know, making goofy faces and everything like that. And at the end, they tear down the side of the tire fort and drag her off to be basically raped to death.
Not basically. No, I think the cop later on actually says she was raped to death, and the third from last guy had syphilis.
Yeah.
I don't know how they can.
And it's played for comedy, of
what
course.
What order doesn't all get mixed? Oh yeah. God.
And that ties into the junkyard owner who tried to rape Wendy and failed. So unsuccessfully, he wanders off and finds the dead body of the rape victim and then proceeds to have sex, although we don't mm-hmm. see it, proceeds to have sex with the dead body.
Well, he pries her legs apart and then we cut away and when we cut back, he's doing up his fly.
Right. Yeah.
And he asks the police officer if they can tell one set of semen from another. And that's when we get that brilliant syphilis line.
Yeah. Right. Third from last. They said that to make sure that he knew that you're going to get syphilis because you put your penis in there. And he scratches his junk at the time.
That's
so
right.
Totally that he had sex with the dead body.
Mm-hmm. Comedy gold, ladies and gentlemen.
Comedy gold.
Prior to that, we had the character of, you know, the older brother who had some sympathetic qualities. And mm-hmm. the guy who was the junkyard, he was a creep and, you know, a bit of a lech, but he was a little bit humorous in that role. And then they have him try to assault Wendy and then have sex with a corpse, you know, and you're just like, was this necessary?
Yeah. And he even had that one protesting line at the beginning where Wendy was like, you're always trying to fuck me against my will or something. And he was like, hey, I don't have sex with nobody that doesn't want it. And I'm like, mm-hmm. okay, so he's just creepy and he's not actually a terrible person. And then later in the movie, it's like, oh, no, he's... No. Just lying there. He's,
no, in
he's
his mind, everyone
terrible.
Wants it.
Yes.
Yeah, I guess
I think
so.
That is
no one's
point.
Getting out of this alive.
Yeah, I think about this film as a whole, the thing that I found most curious, the thing that really struck me as odd, and everything about this movie is odd. There's not one thing in this movie that's not odd. But the thing that I think I found most odd was what was presented as comedy.
Right.
The comedy portions. And you knew which ones were the comedy portions. Not because they were funny.
No.
But because they had a comedy soundtrack. And you're like, oh.
Yeah.
Oh, the director believes this is the funny part. So that was the one that I found the strangest. Well, mm-hmm. By far.
I think one scene in this movie that I thought was legitimately funny. And that's when the black gentleman who wears the gas mask all the time is shoplifting.
Right.
There's a scene where he goes to steal half of a watermelon and put it down his hobo pants, but he stops and reconsiders and instead gets like...
Because it's too big, obviously.
He gets two giant cassava melons instead.
Yes, yeah. That so he takes fun. Two melons that equally add up to the same size as the watermelon.
Yes.
He just gets to put them down each one down each pant leg.
Right.
So that, I do agree that it was legitimately funny. But all the other moments, and there are... more than a couple that are presented as comedy that are not funny at all. And That's what I'd like to hear about from the director.
Well, Roy Frumkes wrote the screenplay, and he said, "I wrote it to democratically offend every group on the planet, and as a result, the youth market embraced it as a renegade work, and it played midnight shows."
Now, what else has Roy Frumkes written?
The Substitute and all of its sequels.
So, The Substitute, starring Tom Berenger, as a kick-ass substitute teacher in a, you know, in a hard luck school. That wasn't a bad film.
And it's three sequels.
Huh.
We haven't talked about The Cop at all.
We haven't talked about The Cop at all.
That's true. All right, let's talk about The Cop.
Yeah, yeah. So there is a scene where our cop, who's been basically kicking ass and taking names, he's all the way along. You know, he is obviously a bad cop, but not in a dirty cop way. He doesn't take handouts.
But we never see his badge.
He would never see his badge, but he does abuse everybody that he comes in contact with.
Yeah, he's a very angry person.
Very, very angry person. And he's warned to not go after Bronson by himself because that guy's a psycho. But he eventually decides, he knows that Bronson's the guy, and he's sick and tired of, like, you know, this guy getting away with all this stuff. So he's going to go out and get him. He's a real cowboy, and not just because he's wearing those boots. Oh, yeah. Okay, hold on. We gotta start from the beginning with the cop.
Okay.
Right?
Okay.
Because he's introduced. He comes into the play when Bronson murders a
nerd,
by ramming his head through his own windshield.
Yeah.
And the cop comes in to solve this murder. And he's like, he costs a bum and says, "You bums know what's going on here. I'm coming back to find you. So you better tell me who did this," right? And then 5 minutes later, somebody who melts from Viper in a fire escape, a big glob of the melting body hits an innocent bystander and melts his face off.
I think that might have been Roy Frumkes.
I think that was, because he's credited as melted businessman.
Oh, that's Roy Frumkes himself, is the melting face. And he runs into the police officer, to which bystanders say, "Help him, stop his pain, do something for him." And his reply is, "I can only help one person at a time,
lady. One person at a time."
So why it's not the guy who's melting is the person that he's deciding to help, I don't know. But he basically does nothing for this person whose face melts off.
Well, what could you do, really?
Call an ambulance.
The ambulance was already there.
Call a paramedic who's right there to come on over. This guy's face is melting. Do something.
Push the people back.
Push people back? Anything. He did absolutely... The only thing he did...
Was argue
with the lady who was telling him to get help. So I think, you know... Nicely established character early on, because he did not waver from that. There was no character arc to this character at all.
Here's your one note.
He had a note and he stuck to it. He played it like I played the recorder in grade 2. Played that one note you had perfected for all it's worth. And he did it well. He was very angry and he was a sizable gentleman.
Yeah, he's big. He's a big man.
Bigger than everybody else that he came up against.
So he had that fight with Bronson.
Fight with the hitman.
Fight with the hitman, sure. In the fancy coat. I really liked his coat.
That hitman had some very... I'm not a fashion plate, but he had some clashing plaid.
So the hitman was hired...
Yeah.
The hitman was hired by the mob boss.
By the mob boss.
We have not talked about it. Because... Really, barely worth mentioning.
Yeah. Because it's his girlfriend that was gang raped and murdered by the hobos.
And the cops investigating that.
So this the hitman, you know, through his underworld connections, I guess, figured out who brought the girl to the junkyard to become a victim, and is chasing the older brother around the junkyard.
Yep.
And the cop just so happens to be standing right there. The hitman gets the drop on him with a gun. And the cop doesn't have a gun out.
Yes.
And the cop stops him from shooting him by saying,
"Wouldn't you rather die in combat than rot in jail?"
It's a convincing argument.
It is.
Is it? Is it an argument? Because if you've got the drop on the guy.
Yeah, with your gun pointing at his face.
If you got the drop on his face, you shoot him and then you walk away.
And you do neither of those
and
things.
And neither of those things happen. You don't die in battle or rot in jail. I don't know, but he... Somehow this convinced him to put...
He rolled a 20 on his persuasion roll.
But here's the thing.
He heard the Valkyries blowing their horns, calling him to Valhalla.
I guess. Because even if he puts his gun down and triumphs over the cop and beats him to death instead of shooting him to death, won't the rotting in jail premise still be valid?
Maybe he's just like, I like a good fight.
Yeah, but the police officer prevails, beats him to death, and then stuffs his head in a stand-up urinal.
Oh, that's right.
And puts his finger down his own throat and vomits on his dead body.
Yeah.
Paul, you got to have a theory about this because I am befuddled.
That's his calling card, isn't it?
Oh. What? He vomited on him?
Best policeman ever.
Oh, he's a throw-up cop.
He didn't do it before or after. Oh, maybe that's how he could have helped the melting guy. He could have thrown up his melting face and stopped the burning.
Look, I only got enough vomit for one guy, and I'm going to use it on the guy I killed.
My theory is that ordinarily you would piss on your vanquished foe's corpse, but they've already done that twice in this movie. So
the pissing happened later.
Yeah.
Or was there one before as well?
Well, there was Bronson getting peed on accidentally, and then Bronson does pee on the cop when he defeats him in Glorious Battle.
Right.
Yeah.
So they probably thought there's just too much pissing in this movie, and that would be a little bit in poor taste. So they've got to vary the bodily fluids up.
You know what it was?
Right.
Because you're in a bathroom. If you're going to go pee, you pee in the urinal. It's right there.
Yeah.
So you got to do something else.
It's too obvious.
Got to go with the vomit. Yeah.
Well, you know what? Maybe it's just a classic misdirect, right? Because he does stick his head like in the bottom of the urinal, and you're like, wow, he's going to pee on him now.
Nope.
And then he
fooled you.
He fooled me yet again. The director shakes it up with vomit.
Or maybe this is his way of covering up the murder that he just committed of this guy by saying, oh, the guy got totally drunk, got vomited and passed out and killed himself by hitting
himself. Vomit in his mouth, but all in the back of his head.
Well, vomited all over. He's super drunk, right?
Okay.
Fell down.
So,
gratuitous bump.
It's right after this that the cop decides, well, now I got to go after Bronson. You know, he's got the blood on his knuckles from beating the hitman to death.
Mm-hmm. Can't stop.
He threatens the mob boss, telling him that he's going to get out of his car and beat him to death. The mob boss drives off.
Because he's smart. Like, he's not, he doesn't fall for his persuasion roles.
And the cop is so wound up, and now he's out of his car. He got out of his car. He can't go back in and drive away.
Yeah.
He's like, now's the time to go after Bronson. And it's a knockdown, drag out, like literally lifting people over their heads and flinging them into walls.
Yeah, professional wrestling.
Professional wrestling style junkyard dog fight. And Bronson comes out ahead.
Yeah, and the cop dies.
Yep.
And that's the end of the cop.
Yep. Yep. And they give him like one of those classic stone burials in the junkyard. See, that's the thing is like when you describe any one scene from Street Trash, it almost sounds like a movie.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But taken together, holistically speaking, like there's no pattern, there's no obvious connection from one scene to the other. Like, I mean, in any other movie, there would be a through line throughout the entire movie that leads up to the final confrontation between Bronson and the two brothers. But we never really get that. And
so, I mean, the only interaction that Bronson has with either of the two brothers before the final scene is where he threatens him with the knife right before he cuts off the penis.
Yeah.
That is the only time either of the brothers run into Bronson at all in the course of the film.
Which makes it very confusing for that final chase scene.
Yes.
When Wendy and the younger brother are about to get it on.
Yes.
And Bronson suddenly comes rampaging in and wants to kill everyone.
Yes. Well, he does call him a gook lover. Right. So it's
he's in full PTSD.
Yeah. So I guess this is
out of his mind.
The theory is that he's like locked in one of his Vietnam flashbacks.
Right, because he wants Wendy.
With Viet Cong vampires.
Yes.
Yes, that's right.
There were Viet Cong vampires.
There were Viet Cong vampires.
And explosions while kissing was happening.
And a flashback showing him making his femur knife using a knife he already had.
Yes.
I'm like, I'm going to make a knife with this knife.
See, this is the thing that I think is the most fascinating is the character that gets the most development is Bronson in this movie.
Yeah.
He's the bad guy. He's the antagonist, but we understand more of his plight than anybody else in the entire film.
We have a theory that either the director or the writer or both dislike humankind.
Yeah.
They really hate people.
Yep.
And they think that everyone is awful all the time. And so this is their worldview. And so they write and create a movie to reflect that. That everyone is awful and no one is good.
You should all just melt.
And the only thing that has any redemptive quality whatsoever is a thing that will kill all these people instantly.
Yeah.
Yes.
It felt like this was...
In a horrible way.
In a horrible way.
It felt like somebody playing a like a god game, like, you know, Civilization or Sim, you know, Sim City or something like that, where you then just fuck with everybody and go, ha ha ha, I hate you all, I'm a god. And that's what the creator of this movie was doing, was like, I'm going to set up all these people and show you why I don't like them, and then a bunch of them are going to melt and die.
Yeah. Well,
you're not supposed to like Bronson, but at least we can understand where he's coming from. We see like what the war has done to him. And we do see a little bit of that with the brothers as well, when they're, you know, trying to look out for one another, and, you know, they've got this background of their sad runaways and stuff like that.
I think you hit the nail on the head that Bronson is the only character with a backstory. Really, truly.
Yeah, do we get it from anybody else? Like, we don't even get it from what we think is our protagonist, which is the alcohol. They just, oh, we just find it.
Yep.
The Viper. Yep. Oh, look what I found down in the basement. I guess I'll sell this.
I would love to see a TV edit of this film to see what scenes they would insert to try and explain why Tenafly Viper does what it does. Like, there was a famous version, a TV edit version of Repo Man, where their explanation for why people would melt when they opened the trunk was that the devil himself was inside of it. So they inserted scenes with like the license plate with like 666 on it and like a Baphomet face and like an evil devil laugh. Like they added footage to try and make the film make more sense. So I'm wondering if there's a version of Street Trash out there that does something similar with Tenafly Viper.
Well, the problem with a TV edit of Street Trash is that it would be a minute and a half long. It would be a although it does pattern itself to be a comedy. So, I mean, the 22 minutes is a sitcom length. So
there you go.
It could be the Street Trash sitcom.
Yeah, and they could recut it so that Bronson is sort of like the next door neighbor character, you know, the wacky one.
Right. Yes.
The Kramer of the series.
Yes. By the way, in his flashbacks, he doesn't have his hobo beard.
Oh, that's right.
He is not nearly so menacing without that beard.
Yeah, that big baby face of his. Yeah. Holy cow.
Yeah, he does not. Well, Joe was actually confused for a couple of seconds. He's like, who the hell is that guy? I'm like, it's Bronson without a beard. What?
Yeah.
What is happening? Oh, and then there was a confusion between flashbacks about what was a flashback and what wasn't a flashback, because most of the flashbacks took place in Vietnam, but one of them, he was in the junkyard.
Yeah. Right.
So then it was like, oh, I think this is actually happening because he's not in Vietnam during this one. But then it was Viet Cong vampires were like, no,
he never left
that's
Vietnam.
Not actually happening. But I wouldn't have been surprised if Viet Cong vampires did actually happen.
I wanted to see that movie.
Yeah.
Viet Cong vampires.
I wanted to see the Viet Cong vampires and him fight them off. That's the movie I want to see.
Yeah, that's like Rambo 7,
maybe,
right?
That's the maybe that's the prequel that we need to Street Trash, except that it's actually real.
Yeah.
Like, he's got PTSD because he was literally attacked by
Viet Cong vampires. Yeah, he becomes way more sympathetic under those circumstances.
Yeah.
So back to your point, the beginning of the finale, when he bursts into the room as Wendy and the younger brother are about to have sex.
Yep.
Yeah.
And calls him a gook lover and chases him around the junkyard for a very long time.
We needed yakety sacks for that.
Yep.
Totally.
And there was a comedy moment. He does get away from Bronson when he has a grip on him by sacking him, by hitting him in the testicles. Yep. Right?
Yep.
And then, of course, Bronson is about to kill the older brother. He has him over his head.
The older brother?
Yeah, this is the end of the fight. The older brother.
This is the end of the fight. Up.
Okay.
Where the older brother has shown up. He threw a bottle of Viper in Bronson's face again.
Oh, yes.
The hero of the movie trying to take Bronson down a notch.
Right. That's right, the Viper, not the older brother.
He had a big Viper scorch on the side of his face.
Yep.
And the older brother is about to be savaged by Bronson, and he's getting beaten within an inch of his life. And the younger brother, in classic Jaws style, employs a high-pressure canister.
Yeah.
Some kind of gas.
And he knocks the end of it off, and it flies through the air like a rocket.
Like a rocket. And, like an air torpedo.
And hits Bronson perfectly in the head.
Yeah.
And this is by far and away the best. They spent half the budget of the movie on this prosthetic,
The other half being the toilet scene.
Nothing for anything else. Precisely. But there is Bronson's body, headless body, is standing there spurting blood. And as you're watching it, Joe uttered what happened to the head. And as he said it, the head falls into frame in the background.
Yeah.
That is quite brilliant. That is That is my favorite shot of the movie, without a shadow of a doubt. And a very realistic prosthetic body that's spurting blood with the head.
It falls back lifelessly next to the older brother.
Very realistic disembodied head that actually has, its eyes are still moving, even though it's been
The severed head that when Wendy walks over on top of it, he looks at her her panties.
Yes, there is an upskirt shot from the point of view of a severed head. And so that he can die happy.
Because that's what he deserves.
And he kind of smiles a little bit, and then he expires.
And they live happily ever after.
Smash cut to credits.
They live trashily ever after.
Trashily ever after.
Mm-hmm. So this film, how do we want to rate this one, gentlemen?
I think 3 out of 10 is generous.
I am going to give it a 1 out of 10.
Oh, okay.
And the only reason it's not a 0... is because of that, hey, where's the head? there it is. Perfectly framed. In slow motion, no less.
Yep.
That's worth a whole point. I thought it was so finely composed.
I have to give it a 2 because of the Steadicam shots that made me go, the guy operating the Steadicam's pretty good. and the special effects in a few of the scenes, like the first melting and then the body at the end was certainly good. That's worth 2 points. So everything else is like trash.
None of us are giving it any scores based on content. We're all giving it technical scores.
Yeah,
this I'm giving him some plus ones because of the body explosions.
Right. Got it.
The meltings.
Got it. But story, terrible. Terrible. Acting, atrocious.
Paul, what's your rating?
Oh, I'd say probably about 7.5 out of 10. And here's my explanation why, though.
Okay. All right.
Okay.
It does have some pretty incredible special effects, practical stuff that still grosses you out, even if it's weird with the choice of color, for example. Strange in that respect.
Paul, let me ask you one question. Your scale, does it start at 5? Like, is 99% of movies made 10 out of 10s for you?
No, actually, it's weird because I'm not normally the one who gives, like, the positive score to things. Like, people always tell me I hate everything.
Okay. It gives me some perspective, that's all. Please continue with your commentary on this film. But why it is deserving of a 7.5?
Well, I think one of the things, I really like the camera work, the Steadicam work in it. Yep. There were parts like the melon scene that we mentioned that I thought were legitimately humorous. I like that character. I think one of the reasons that I give this film Halo points is because of the subject matter that it deals with, not well, not in a nuanced fashion, but very few films really have the bravery to have your entire main characters to be homeless schizophrenics. And dealing with just the absolute forgotten dregs of society, and in a couple of places nodding toward the problems like of Vietnam, for example, and the veterans coming back and being just, you know, not getting the support that they needed. And so maybe that speaks to me.
You didn't think Deer Hunter maybe touched on it a little better?
Or Fisher King?
Deer Hunter did it with nuance, though. I mean, like in Deer Hunter, you've got a character who's, you know, a multiple amputee. You've got a character who never leaves and ends up killing himself in a game of Russian roulette because he's addicted to the thrill. You've still basically got a lot of white middle class values going on. This is way below that. I mean, this doesn't even enter like poverty levels in terms of class. And it's a movie that is gross and offensive and unashamedly so. And I mean, granted, you know, the makeup isn't that great. When you see the high definition remaster struck from the original negative, it's clear that they've just got stuff smeared on their faces. But I mean, this is a movie that smells bad. You get an olfactory sense of it in places. And I don't know. I guess I have to give the director credit for having vision, even if his reach far outstretched his grasp.
So you admire the fact that the writer said, I want to offend everyone, and he succeeded.
Yes, I have to give him some credit for setting out and accomplishing what he did. Whether his goal was worthy is an entirely different argument.
Entirely different conversation.
And this is the thing that I can say about Street Trash, sort of rounding out my criticism of it, is it is an unforgettable film, except for the parts that you wish you could forget.
I was about to say, I wish I agree with that sentiment that there are parts of this movie that are now indelibly burned in my brain. And I'm not happy about that.
Well, yeah. So this is why after watching it last night, I'm like, I got to apologize. We've got bums exploding left and right.
Exploding constantly. It's really, it's the cleanup
crew.
See,
but you're talking about things like that I think are again, they're beyond this person's grasp. You know, it's like one of those things. Yeah, like, I think this movie is overtly political. I just don't think it has anything particularly intelligent to say.
Decipherable sound recording is beyond this filmmaker's grasp. Yeah.
Well, should we do Lesser of Two Evils?
Let's do it.
So in Brain Damage, you've got, you're being paired with Aylmer.
Yep.
He's giving you hallucinations, but he's also causing you to go out and find people for him to kill.
He's giving you the juice.
The juice.
Or in Street Trash, drinking Viper and dying a quick but horrible death.
Ah. Oh, interesting. So in the Brain Damage scenario, you can't stay around any of your friends or family or loved ones.
Right, because they could be killed and eaten.
The Aylmer will inevitably get around to eating their brains. Yeah. And you will have been party to it. And you can't get off the juice because you're heavily addicted. But you do get bouts of orgasmic euphoria.
You get the orgasmic euphoria, and it's not really clear whether or not you're going to die at the end.
Right, right. Well, I mean, in this scenario, you're not necessarily going to get the full, like, squeezed Aylmer into your brain.
Right.
So,
oh, that's true.
You may just go on, like, the old people, and, like, 40 years later,
if you're evil and don't care, you can just find your brains and keep getting high.
Uh-huh. Now, the flip side of that is drinking Viper. Do you get any sort of, I guess you don't even get a chance to get any alcoholic buzz off of that Viper before you start melting.
No, it's like 3 seconds and horror. Right. The horror begins.
Right, right. Right, but are you a bum? Are you a hobo?
No, I'm me.
You're you. Okay, all right. So you don't even get the sweet relief of your hobo life. You know, get out of your horrible situation.
The freedom.
Freedom.
The glorious freedom.
Yeah. Freedom through death.
Of having no options but to sit on a street.
Yeah.
Ah, freedom.
Wow, I mean, it seems very simple on the surface, but
it's tricky.
Yeah,
because the death from Viper is terrible and quick and painful. Like, it's quick and painful. Like, for like what, 30 seconds that you're feeling it, and we don't even know how long. It seems that you live a long time, even though your entire body is turning to goo.
Do you think now I have to get rid of all my friends and family?
Yeah.
Do you think that Aylmer will become my friend?
He's very.
He seemed nice if you gave him brains.
He pretends to be your friend, but I don't think he really cares for you with the ease with which he switches hosts, for example. He's ready to ditch.
Right. Yeah, he is going to ditch you at some point, and then you're going to be in that super agonizing, mouth foaming pain like those old people.
How long does that last, though?
Well, it lasts long enough that they can be in agony, and then they start to look like pale and washed out and stuff, and like they're scrambling trying to find
him. How long do
we
figure he had Aylmer in him? Like, how long did he? How much time do you think?
3 days, maybe.
3 days, and 3 days later, they were still so desperate that they had a gun and were like, "Give him back!" Right?
Yeah.
I'm wondering if you will eventually come down from that.
So this is kind of a horrible life versus a horrible death.
Yeah.
Right. I guess you know what I think it comes down to. Do you have human feelings and a conscience?
Yeah.
Are you like a sociopath? Because if you are a non-sociopath, this is a pretty awful way to go. Going around murdering strangers and or friends and family and being enslaved to this creature that...
Could I negotiate with Aylmer? Could I be like, listen, maybe how about monkey brains? Because they're almost human. And then I don't
mind
so
much. Well, you see where
that
got Brian.
Yeah.
That got Brian... Now I'm going to make you wait for it.
Yeah, it's clear that Aylmer has all of the negotiating power in that scenario.
Yeah. But you do get the orgasmic euphoria.
Yeah, that orgasmic euphoria is pretty...
it's tipping the scales pretty heavy.
This is one of the roughest, will you sacrifice yourself or be terrible?
Yes, because
choices.
If you drink the Viper and go the way of the hobo...
It is a horrible, horrible death.
Horrible death. But no one near you, unless you drink it near your friends and
party,
family...
At a
dinner party with your friends and family. If you don't do that, then at least you're saving your friends and loved ones a possible proxy death, you know?
So basically, I'm in a room, and Aylmer's there, and I'm addicted to his juice, and there's a bottle of Viper. And Elmer's like, oh, yeah. Be with me forever. And I'm like, I got my one way out. Do I drink that bottle of Viper? Or do I listen to Elmer?
That's a good way of putting it. What do you think, Joe? You got a conclusion?
I would like to hope that I would drink the Viper.
Right.
I don't know if that's true.
Uh-huh.
But I'm going to choose it and be honest that I might be weak.
Uh-huh.
But I would like to think that I would.
I think you would have a moment. I think you have a moment. And it only takes a moment.
Yeah.
Because it doesn't take long to take
it doesn't take much Viper.
Yeah. So you just take one sip and you're dead.
I'd be like, as
you
long explode. As I can save lots of people's lives and if I just open that bottle and drink it.
Joe has a conscience.
Oh, I do. You know that.
What about you, Paul? Do you have a conclusion?
I had a real hard time with this one, mostly because it is sort of the choice between a horrible death or a horrible life. But ultimately, I think I would have to go with the Viper myself because Elmer is going to leave you inevitably. Then you're going to go through all of the pains of withdrawal, and possibly that will kill you in a way that would be slower and more painful than the Tenafly Viper. Yeah. Plus, you would have to sacrifice your conscience and be a party of the murder of countless innocent people.
Yeah.
So there's a willing complicity in going with Elmer, whereas Tenafly Viper, people drink it by accident. You know, I mean, they might be bad people and bad things might be happening to them, but it's not something that is, you know, it's more of a, I don't know. It seems like an unconscious evil is.
Yeah. There's no intent for evil.
Yeah. You have human feelings. I understand that, Paul. That says volumes about you.
I like that you're pointing this out about both of us. I'm wondering if you have an opposite reaction.
Well, I mean, Toren, I think, you know, he prefers the animal kingdom to the society of man. We all know this.
I want to believe.
Is Elmer an animal? Because if he is, then you could end up on the animal food chain.
I want to believe that through some point in our relationship, me and Elmer.
That you bond?
Elmer. That I can find out more information about him.
Stockholm syndrome. Fool.
That I can maybe unlock some secrets.
That he could be your only friend. You don't need friends and loved ones because then you got Elmer.
I got Elmer.
Yeah.
Maybe we can work together. Maybe we can work out some kind of arrangement.
Start learning how to clone people. Make cloned human brains.
I don't think that's going to happen.
Yeah.
But maybe, you know, I want to know more about him.
Right, so you're gonna go with the Elmer situation, not because of the orgasmic euphoria or the going against the other way because you don't want to die soon. You just like the lore.
You
just
want to,
in a very Dungeons and Dragons way, you want to write Elmer's monster manual write up.
Maybe even more in a Call of Cthulhu kind of way.
Right, there you go. Good times.
I want to investigate.
Especially knowing that, you know, if you take enough of the juice, you could have like a possibly an interdimensional portal too. You know, some great old ones thing or something or other.
So the promise
of the future, you're going to see it through.
I'm going to see it through.
Well, maybe. I'm going to split it right down the middle because I'm going with the Elmer situation as well. Not because I don't have human feelings, because I kind of suspect that's part of Torrance's thing. But because I do have human feelings, but this would be a great excuse for me to travel. Because, you know, I'm always like looking for a reason to like, you know, get out and about. And I don't really want to put my friends and family in harm's way.
Right.
So I just get out and see the world.
Let's go kill some foreigners.
Yes, absolutely.
Because fuck them.
So, Paul, where can we listen to the Greatest Movie Ever podcast?
You can find the Greatest Movie Ever podcast at gmepodcast.com.
Well, thank you so much for joining us.
That was a real pleasure,
for
Paul.
For our inaugural... what are we calling it?
Caustic Soda Cinematastrophes.
Well, we are very happy.
Okay, well, thanks for having me.